Thank you and welcome. Is this okay? I'm pleased to introduce to you Geshe Pema Dorjee, who will be talking tonight in the first of six evenings that we will be having here at the Tibet House. I wanted to tell you a little bit about him. Geshe Pema Dorjee was born in Tibet to a nomadic family. He and his family escaped the Chinese by crossing over the Himalayas when he was 9 years old. They traveled at night on foot for 18 days. Ultimately, he was educated in India, where he received the Geshe degree, which I'm sure you know is the highest academic degree that one can attain in the Tibetan Buddhist academic world. For many years, he was in charge of TCV, the Tibetan Children's Village in Dharamsala, where he had a mere 2,500 students under his authority. Almost all were orphans. Amongst his many other jobs and achievements, it's worth pointing out that he was also director of the Institute of Higher Buddhist Studies. Some years ago now, His Holiness asked Geshe La to do his best to revive one particular tradition within Tibetan Buddhism which had become almost extinct. It's called the Bodang tradition. And to do this, Geshe La embarked on two paths. One was as a scholar, in which he established an institute and still runs it to try and unearth all of the Bodang teachings, and then to translate them, and then to publish them. And the other path he undertook was to establish and run a monastery, which he still runs, in Kathmandu, Nepal, where young monks are actually educated in the old Bodang tradition and will hopefully go out into the world and really bring it to life again. Geshe La is a scholar, a teacher, and a humanitarian. He teaches about compassion, yes, but he practices what he preaches. Amongst the projects that he has seen the need for and established are schools, orphanages, even a bridge, bringing clean water to a remote village, creating a safe home for street girls in Kathmandu, working with a drug rehabilitation center, doing his best to educate villagers to avoid being victims of human trafficking, setting up a scholarship fund for girls who are, shall we say, at risk of various behaviors. As far as medical care is concerned, his humanitarian work can involve anything from one sick person that he sees on the street to establishing and running a mobile eye care clinic that goes to the far reaches of the Himalayas and brings everything from eyeglasses to eye surgery. Recently, after the April earthquake in Nepal, he and the monks from his monastery were personally involved in bringing rice, tents, and blankets to the victims. One important project that he's been involved with is trying to bring clean cook stoves to that part of the world, because those of you who have been there know that where people live three generations in one small hut, there's an open wood fire that burns all day and all night, not just for cooking, but to provide light and heat as well. And as a result, the people are becoming blind or have lung diseases. And here's a little statistic you didn't know. Guess what is the greatest killer of children worldwide under the age of five? You might have guessed malaria or AIDS or congenital diseases or starvation. The answer is the cook stoves that are used worldwide that almost literally poison them from the smoke. And he is doing his best to bring more modern, efficient cook stoves to that part of the world. My wife Carol and I met Geshe Pema Dorjee in Dharamsala some 8 or so years ago, and learned that he devotes about a third of each year to lecturing, more than a third, two-thirds?
to lecturing
all over the world, but had never been to the United States. So we asked him if he would come to the United States, and so far each year he has been willing to come on a month-long tour of the United States and share his learnings with you. Finally, I wanted to mention that we set up to help fund Geshe La's humanitarian projects an organization called Tibetan Buddhist Charitable Aid, or TBCA. It's an official 501c3 charity. What's unique about it is that 100% of contributions go directly to the projects that I mentioned to you. There are no overhead bills. And a lot of the charities that you're familiar with, a third to as much as a half are used for things like advertising and staff and buildings and transportation and so on. That is not the case with TBCA. Geshe La never charges for any of his talks, nor would he ever. On the other hand, that hasn't discouraged Carol and me from sort of piggybacking onto his talks to see if there's anyone in the audiences who might want to contribute to helping his charitable projects. And so if you would like to do so, simply see Carol afterwards. She's seated in the front row. And for those of you out there in Etherland, feel free to look up BuddhistCharity.org for more information. Enough from me. You came here to hear Geshe Pema Dorjee. Geshe La. We're listening.
Do we need to have a short break in between? Or last year, what did we do? I don't remember. Okay. So maybe after 1 hour, we can have a short break, about 10 minutes. So I'm very happy to be here. I think this is fifth time in Tibet House. And thank you so much for allowing us to give talk or whatever you say, teaching. And so normally when we give teaching, so I say some prayers and like this. So I do the, a little bit like traditional, not 100%. Okay, yeah. So I say some prayer, and then we start the teaching. Okay.
Manju
I think according to our time, reading the scriptures and then explaining will be not possible. So I just go, I will try to take, prepare myself, and then I will explain. And then I think there are a few translations, you see. Shantideva's text is translated into English. I think there are few translations. I think I saw about five. And the earliest translation is Stephen Batchelor's translation, which I rely mostly on his translation. And then Padmakara translation is also very good. Rest of the translation, I really don't know. I didn't read in detail. Padmakara translation is done by a group of very good scholars. And also it was guided by Thangur Rinpoche. So sometimes I read this translation. And and then when it comes to like translation, it's a little bit difficult. So time to time, we have to explain a little bit more. My friend Stephen also will check. He will say that what does it mean, you say, because I'm using English term, but then whether it's really exactly same as a Tibetan term or not, then we try to explain from Tibetan, from my Tibetan understanding. So, and this is one thing. Another thing is that in Tibetan we say chunjuk chemo. In Sanskrit, some translation there is Bodhisattva's way of life, okay? So this teaching of Shantideva's text, I think I received from Isolin Dalai Lama at least like three times. And the longest and the most detailed teaching I received was in Bodh Gaya, about 10 days. And almost like whole day, you see, in the morning, 3 hours, and then afternoon, something like 4 hours, 10 days, you see. And therefore, I say that if I give teaching on Bodhisattva's way of life, is one of the factor is this very important. And then His Holiness received teaching from Kundalama Rinpoche, and then also from his tutors. And I think he referred to his Kundalama Rinpoche's teaching quite a lot. One of the, I think, greatest Bodhisattva ever produced in 20th century. Great spiritual teacher. Time to time, I might go to some of his texts also. But then we have to run. We are busy, so we don't have much time. So every day we have about 2 hours. That too is, I think now almost like 10 minutes already gone. Therefore, we have to run. Okay, today we have to finish about 3 chapters, and which is quite impossible. But we will try. Okay. If this is today is not possible, then tomorrow will be more impossible. You see. So therefore, we have to run. But then, therefore, I told you that going word by word is almost impossible. So I just explained about the first chapter from about 5-6 points I pick up, and then I explain, and then you read the text, and then your English is much, much, 1,000 times better than me. Therefore, I think this will be fine. Yeah. And then terms in the beginning, you see. In Tibetan, we have a term which is called lung, okay? And this is translated into English as a scripture. And then the definition or the meaning of lung is much more than a scripture, you see. That I think I'd really like to explain a little bit more, because Shantideva wrote this text based on Buddha's teaching. And all the Buddha's teaching, these are called lung, you see, lung. Why these are called lung? Because these are so 100% reliable. 100% reliable. And these are meant to reduce or remove destructive emotions. And to develop all these good qualities like compassion and bodhicitta and so on. So it's not simply a scripture, you see. It's much more. And then in the Dharmakriti's text, he defined this lung. That lung means, lung, in Tibetan term, lung means, it is a teaching which helps us, guides us to reduce destructive emotions like hatred or jealousy or ego or desire. And it gives us strength to develop, okay, all the good qualities till we reach to enlightenment. And this is the meaning of the lung, okay? Scripture, I don't know. Exactly, I don't know what is the meaning of scripture, I don't know. But it is translated scripture. So so this is a little bit like a clarification from my side. So when we read Buddha's teaching or like texts like Shantideva's, these are totally focused, okay. They practiced, okay. They really practiced, and then they realized, okay. And then they wrote. It's not like reading a book, another book, and then doing like a research and writing another book. It's not like this, you see. They read the book, try to understand, and then to try to contemplate, and try to meditate, and then get the experience, okay, realize after meditation. And then if they found that this is really true, whatever is taught in the scripture, if they practice, and then we really achieve the same what is explained. Therefore, it is just not only a scripture, you see, it's much more than scripture. Lung is very important. Therefore, Shantideva says, he wrote this Bodhisattva's way of life, relying on Buddha's scriptures, okay, Buddha's teachings. Okay, so therefore, if you just read a scripture and then there's not much meaning. When you read lung that is very, very important. Where it is rooted, okay? Where it is rooted? Buddha's teaching. And what Buddha teaching, what he taught us, then it is just totally. Why? Because his teachings are rooted to compassion. compassion. And compassion means really strong intention to remove the suffering and sources of suffering from every sentient being. Therefore, whatever he taught to us has to be like to help or guide us to remove suffering and sources of suffering. Therefore, the meaning of lung is very deep. Of course, I can't say it's wrong, but when I say scripture, then I don't get the same meaning. Therefore, I explained. And now, in the first chapter, in some translations, say benefit of Bodhicitta, and in some translations, it's excellence of the Bodhicitta. So, whatever you say, it is setting the goal, okay, goal of whole Bodhisattva's way of life. The main thing is Bodhicitta, okay? Bodhicitta. Why Bodhicitta is so important? And how we have to develop, what are the benefits after achieving Bodhicitta? That I think I will explain orally. And of course, the explanations are there, so you can read in English. In the beginning, beginning part, okay, it's like he prostrated to Buddha and the Dharma and Sangha. Why? Again, why? The basic foundation of Buddhism is having strong, unshakable faith in Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. There is a foundation, you see. Without this, I think the practice of Buddhism is impossible. Why it is so important? Why Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha? Why we have to go refuge in Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha? Why? Because we suffer and we collect a lot of sources of the suffering. We really like to be free from suffering or free from samsara. For that, we feel so tired or afraid that we will fall into samsara again and again, suffer again and again. So by having this feeling that I really don't want to be born in samsara, it's so much suffering. I really wanted to be free from there. If I really wanted to be free from there, how can I be free? Okay, who will lead me? And then Buddha, the best teacher, and Dharma, the best teaching, guidance, and Sangha, the helper, okay, to be free from samsara. Therefore, in the beginning, he also taught us that we have to go refuge in Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. Why? The main purpose of Buddha's teaching is rooted to compassion. Means every sentient being really like to be free from some suffering, source of suffering, and really wanted to be happy. And then the solution or the how we can be free is by having really strong faith in Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. By having this, okay, then we become Buddhist. We become Buddhist. And therefore, the first part, okay. Now, this is mainly I'm talking from the perspective of how we have to start the practice. Okay, where we are, okay. Do I have really unshakable faith or belief in Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha? Do I have? If you have this, and then whatever you do, based on Buddha's teaching, all become Buddhist practice. If you don't have this, and then it's really difficult to say that your practice is really according to Buddhism. Yeah? Why? Because the main purpose of giving teaching is to be free from suffering and sources of suffering. For that, we need a teacher, really profound teacher, who was Buddha, And then that teacher gives a profound teaching, unmistakable guidance, and that is Dharma. And then on the way, okay, and then we need helper. We need a support. We need also Sangha. So through these, okay, three factors, and then if we try, then maybe it's possible to be free from suffering and social suffering or from samsara, okay? And then if we go a little bit more, then he says, okay, he says, now in this life, we are born as a good human rebirth. Good human rebirth. So, and then what is the most important thing to do? Okay. And then he collected all the scriptures, or lung, okay, lung from different Buddhist teaching, said that the Bodhicitta is the most important thing. Why? Because as soon as our mind is transformed into Bodhicitta, and then to remove destructive emotion will be very easy and very easy, very fast. And then to achieve happiness also will be very, very easy and happy, very easy and very fast. And therefore, born as a human life, having this precious life, and then the most important thing what we can do in this life is to achieve Bodhicitta. Then, what is Bodhicitta? What is Bodhicitta? Why it is so important? What is Bodhicitta? Okay. So when we study, okay, we study about definition of Bodhicitta, and of course we have a few different views, but mainly we rely on Maitreya's text, Alankara, okay? In Tibetan we say Mondokye, Semje Pan Shenriji Yangda Zobe Changju Do. Semje is Bodhicitta. Semje Pan Shenriji Yangda Zobe Changju Do means Bodhicitta is a mind. Okay, Bodhicitta is a mind which is aiming to achieve Buddhahood for the sake of every sentient being. Why? At present, okay, even I'm not capable of solving my own problem, and I make a lot of mistakes. Therefore, I have a lot of limitation. Even I really want to do something good for every sentient being, still there's a lot of limitation. So if we achieve Buddhahood, okay, and then there will be no limit. And that whatever, okay, guidance will be totally perfect, unmistaken, as I explained about lung, you see. So therefore, if I really want to do something for every sentient being, and then first important thing is to achieve Buddhahood, then I will be able to do everything. Therefore, the definition of Bodhicitta is wish, okay, to achieve Buddhahood. Not for myself, okay, it's impossible. If I say I wanted to achieve Buddhahood for the sake of myself, impossible, okay, there's no way you can achieve. If I say, okay, now so many sentient beings are suffering, and so many sentient beings need happiness, and to remove suffering forever and to achieve happiness forever, and that is only possible if I really achieve Buddhahood, then I can help or guide, give teaching. Okay? Therefore, to achieve Buddhahood is so important for the sake of every sentient being. Therefore, I repeat the definition of Bodhicitta. Bodhicitta is a mind, okay, which is aiming to achieve Buddhahood for the sake of other sentient being. Semjepani Shenriji Yangda Zobe Changju Do. Semjepani, the explanation says, Semjepani Shenriji Yangda Zobe Changju Do Dangye. Semjepani Shenji Tundu. Semjepani Bodhicitta. Shenji Tundu means for the sake of others. Yangda Zobe Changju Do Dangye means for the sake of every sentient being wanting to achieve Buddhahood. Now, so that is the most meaningful, the Shantideva says that this is the most meaningful thing to do in in a life which has so much potential, so much opportunity, being born as a human life is so much potential, so much opportunity. So, and if we have so much potential, then that is the most and best opportunity we can take. Means if we have Bodhicitta, we are, I don't know, okay, now I'm putting myself as an example, okay? I say, I think my mind is filled with so many bad karmas, sin or non-virtuous action. And therefore, when I started doing something good, I get more tired, okay? If I have to do meditation on Bodhicitta about 1 hour, I think I will go like this, you see. Why? Because my mind is loaded with many bad things, you see, contaminations. Yeah. So until unless we don't remove all those obstacles or the contaminations, there's no way we can achieve Buddhahood. So to remove this, the Bodhicitta is the best instrument, okay? But if we transform our mind into Bodhicitta, even to a short, even we don't do meditation, just even we are sleeping, this Bodhicitta can destroy so many bad karmas, non-virtuous actions, okay? Contamination, it can clean so much. Even to accumulate some good karma, if we have no Bodhicitta, it takes ages, but by having Bodhicitta, within very short time, we can earn many good karmas. So therefore, we really wanted to achieve Buddhahood as soon as possible, because so many people, sentient beings are suffering, as soon as possible. That is only possible if our mind is really changed into Bodhicitta. But transforming our mind into Bodhicitta will make us to remove all the negativities easily, very fast, and to achieve all the good qualities very fast, okay? And then it creates a so much sort of hope or confidence, you see, within yourself that, okay, now I think I will try, I will be able to help every sentient being with this, okay? Therefore, Buddha's, again I'm going to the text, Buddha thought, all the Buddha's thought, eons and eons, what will be the best, okay, what will be the best thought, or what will be the best technique, what will be the best teaching for the benefit of all sentient beings? They thought, okay. And then finally the answer was Bodhicitta. Why? Because Bodhicitta has so much potential to remove so many bad things, and Bodhicitta has so much potential to help with many, many good things, you see. So Bodhisattva's way of life, Bodhisattva's way of life is to achieve Buddhahood for the sake of all sentient beings. And that is possible if we are able to cultivate Bodhicitta. And why Bodhicitta is so important? So the roughly what I explained, I think this is the meaning of Bodhicitta, benefit of the Bodhicitta, or excellence of the Bodhicitta, whatever you say. But then, where we are now, are we really close to Bodhicitta, or we are a little bit getting some sort of feeling of Bodhicitta, or we are still quite far, or where we are? That is the most important thing today. I explained Bodhicitta, okay, whatever I know, I tried my best to explain, but most important thing is where we are. Are we really trying to cultivate Bodhicitta? Yes? And if you're trying to cultivate Bodhicitta, then how do you do? How? Just all of a sudden doing something and Bodhicitta, okay, thinking on Bodhicitta, like switch on and off, like. Now Bodhicitta stop, okay, I go to the kitchen, toilet, da-da-da-da. Come back and now on Bodhicitta. Is it like this or what? Where are we? Okay. I'm also included, okay? I often ask, almost every day I ask, where I am, you see? And if we are nowhere, we have to start somewhere, you see? Otherwise, life is shortening every day. And then at the end, if we have nothing in our hand, if we have to go to the next life, it will be very difficult, you see. So therefore, Bodhicitta is very important. Very, very important, as I explained. But then, is it really very near to us, or very near to our heart? Is it, or, it looks, when I listen, it looks very nice. But then, how is my state of mind? Is it close to this or quite far from there? If it's very far, then how can we make closer, you see? So, the taking refuge is the first step. Renunciation, you see? Renunciation is there. I really want to try to remove my suffering, source of suffering. And by thinking this, then I really want to remove the sufferings of other sentient beings. After renunciation, the compassion comes. After compassion, and then automatically the bodhicitta will also come. Therefore, having a strong faith and belief in Buddha, Dharma, Sangha is the foundation. Without this, the cultivation of compassion or cultivation of bodhicitta is not possible. So do we have this? Okay. Do we have a really strong experience of renunciation? That renunciation means I really want you to be free from samsara. That is renunciation, okay? Determination to be free from samsara. And this mind is called renunciation. If we have this strong, I really want you to be free from samsara, okay? Strong determination, we can say that we have renunciation. By having this, and then if we transfer this to other sentient being, I really want you to make every sentient being free from suffering and source of suffering, then that is compassion. And after that, at present, I don't have so much potential to do everything. I really wanted to remove them from suffering. I wanted to make them happy, but I have a lot of limitation. So first important thing is I really wanted to achieve Buddha, then bodhicitta comes. So there's no shortcut, okay. Without practicing renunciation, there's no way you can achieve compassion. Without compassion, there's no way you can cultivate bodhicitta. Therefore, the importance is that bodhicitta is very good. Okay? I think there's no one who says that this is very bad. For the sake of every sentient being, for the sake of means to remove the suffering and source of suffering from every sentient being, and want to make every sentient being very happy and help them to accumulate all the sources of happiness, I think if we say, I want to do this, no one will say, you are doing bad, you see. Everybody will say, this is very good. But then that is, and the, for that, okay, then we need so many things which have to practice. Renunciation, and then compassion, loving kindness. Of course, maybe you all are familiar with the exchange and equalizing, exchanging. Through this method, we can also cultivate bodhicitta. And then seven cause and effect, also these are the techniques or method to cultivate bodhicitta. If you study all this according to its sequences, then I think you will also get the same point as what I'm explaining now. Okay. So the question is where we are. Of course, I can't say that you are in this stage and that, I can't say, but we all have to check. I will check myself. And you all have to check. And that is the main purpose, you see. If you don't check, just listen, then it's like an academic lecture. Okay, that was very good lecture. Very, very good lecture. It was so good and so logic. And then goodbye, okay. But I'm trying to say that we have to practice. You know Milarepa, okay? You know Milarepa, great, great saint. And he says that by having food or by seeing food or by hearing food is not enough, he says. You have to eat the food. After eating food, then you get the satisfaction of your hunger. In the same way, like by hearing some teaching is not enough. Practice, we have to do meditation. Then only we can get the satisfaction, you see. I think most of you might have listened to a lot of teachings, you see. So the main point is we have to practice. Then only if we read some prescription of medicine, okay, a prescription of medicine, we show to the doctor, read the prescription of medicine, we buy the medicine. If we don't eat, if we don't take the medicine, we will never be cured, you see. Therefore, teaching has to be practiced, meditated. Then only whatever I said, like removing suffering, social suffering, all these will happen, you see. And if we take medicine, if we really take medicine, then the disease will be cured. Yeah. Therefore, he said, Sethongwemicho sagavadu, chwetewemicho gomgavadu. Just listening is not enough. We have to meditate. Gomgavadu means needed to be meditated. Yeah. I'm saying this with a good motivation, okay? Just with a good motivation. Because you all spend time coming here, it has to have some meaning. And therefore, I sincerely, including myself, we really have to practice. Yeah. And then I'm taking some teaching from Kunlama Rinpoche, okay? Every one of us has aims and objective, okay? The Buddhahood is highest. And then to become Bodhisattva is also very high. But at least on our level, okay? If someone wanted to be someone who really wanted to be a totally trustworthy person. Just everybody can trust, 100% trust that person also, he says, need Bodhicitta. The person who has Bodhicitta, everybody can trust, 100% trust, you see. If someone is aiming to be a good teacher, okay, good spiritual teacher, whatever, teacher, and Kunlama Rinpoche says that, again, need Bodhicitta. If someone has Bodhicitta, and then that person can be really, really profound, the best teacher. And if that person really wanted to be a good friend of everybody, again need Bodhicitta, you see. Having Bodhicitta, then I think you can be the best friend for everybody, you see. Yeah. And then I think what we have discussed recently and also a few years ago, there are so many issues that if we do good things, at the end we get totally tired or burned out. By having Bodhicitta, you will never get totally burned out, you see. If you do more, it will give more energy, more inspiration. See? And this, therefore, again, Bodhicitta is needed. Mm-hmm. And then, having opportunity to listen teaching about Bodhicitta, or try to understand about Bodhicitta, or try to practice about Bodhicitta, okay? And this itself, okay, itself is a very, very, very fortunate. Very fortunate. Now we all are grown up. I think we all had a very good education and experience and but among all those experiences, whatever we earned up to today, among this, the talking about bodhicitta and the listening about bodhicitta, thinking about bodhicitta, and meditating about bodhicitta, reading book about bodhicitta, that's the most meaningful thing you see, can do in your life. Therefore, again, he says that you really have to read again, again, like Shantideva's text. There are many, okay? The commentaries, I think, maybe, I saw more than 30 commentaries, Indian teachers and Tibetan teachers. I think I might have seen like more than 30 commentaries. If you read each and everything, every explanation or the commentary has its own richness. Yeah. So sometimes we spend a lot of time just talking. And sometimes we spend a lot of time reading newspapers. Of course, we have to know a little bit about the world where we are living. But then spending a lot of time reading newspaper. And some of the old people are just spending the most of their time to reading newspaper, you see. As soon as their newspaper coming, they become very happy, and then they read newspaper. And tomorrow, or day after tomorrow, after 4, 5 days, 1 week, all the news, whatever they collected information are gone. And then after 1 month, and then 1 year, and there's not much left, you see. And by reading newspaper, sometimes we get angry. You see, oh, they killed, why they killed, oh no. And then we get very angry, okay? As a Tibetan, if someone killed Tibetan, I get angry. And then newspaper reading is almost like we are breeding or developing hatred or desire or anger or jealousy, you see. Of course, we can read. I have quite a number of projects in Nepal, so I try to read news about Nepal, you see, just to see how everything is going. Simply, okay, for that purpose, we read, try to listen news about Nepal. We need to read, but still, I think, spend a lot of time is, I think it is not worth. So, because we are, we have a very precious human life, and now it is, myself is now 69 years old from today, and so we are talking about coming next year, but I don't know. Next year is not in our schedule is not in our hand, you see. I can't make any sort of commitment that I will 100% I will come next year. 100%, no, impossible, you see. So therefore, by having a very good understanding first, okay, having good understanding, you will not waste a lot of your time, potential, and so you will focus there. So, first important thing is to understand the bodhicitta. What do you think about the definition of the bodhicitta which I defined? What do you think? Do you agree, or is it okay, or this something impossible, or is it possible, or it's very nice? These days, okay, if someone gives a nice medicine, and if I have headache, and someone gives me a medicine, and if I'm relieved from headache, oh, I have to say thank you, okay? And bodhicitta is much more than a painkiller, you see. It looks quite funny, you see, but it is so important, you see. And then I think to say thank you to Buddha by teaching bodhicitta, and the Shantideva who taught bodhicitta, explained bodhicitta, way how we can achieve bodhicitta, way how can we achieve enlightenment. I don't know. Some questions? First chapter is, means all the Buddhas, Bodhisattvas, thought, what will be the best for every sentient being to remove their suffering and to make them happy? What is the best? Okay, they search, thought, okay, analyze, thought, meditated, practice. Ultimately, the answer was Bodhicitta. Bodhicitta, okay? Yeah. So that is not easy. This is totally confirmed, you see. Of course, we can analyze, we can discuss, we can debate. This is 100% like confirmed. And then there's no other thought which is so powerful to remove suffering and source of suffering. The Bodhicitta is the strongest, okay? To cultivate all the good qualities, the Bodhicitta is the strongest and the fastest. If this is the case, I think then this has to be the main practice of all of us. And then how we have to start? I think I explained, isn't it? Going, taking refuge, cultivating renunciation, cultivating compassion, and then cultivating unusual attitude, and then cultivating bodhicitta. This is the only method. Yeah, and then we think that okay. Yesterday I was explaining about how we can examine our life. Okay, whether it's going in a very nice way or meaningful way or wrong way. I was explaining, and I was telling about Buddha's life. Yeah, Buddha was a princess. Okay, and then according to our mentality, I think he did some stupid things. We might think, you see. He left his wife, beautiful wife. He left his very, very sweet son. And he left his palace, went to forest. What a stupid. If we are asked to do this, I think it is impossible, you see. If we have a very beautiful palace, I think I will stay there. Beautiful wife, very good. Very, very sweet son. Okay, and why should we go to the forest? Why? Because bodhicitta is much more important than this, you see. Renunciation is much more important than this. Compassion is much more important than this. He uses intelligence, he uses wisdom. Therefore, just having a kingdom, just having a wife, just having a son is not enough, you see. It will make a history, short history, but then it will not do anything good, you see. If he renounced from there, went to forest, do meditation, practice bodhicitta, practice wisdom, and then achieve Buddhahood, and he gave this teaching, you see, what we are now trying to listen, trying to practice. And so many great teachers achieved this. So choice is in our hand, you see. Choice in our hand. Now my main purpose is just not explain this, okay? I think many teachers might have explained this. You might have heard many things. You can read this book. But my main purpose is please try to practice. Even if it's really small, just move towards bodhicitta. Just move small, bit by bit. Just go closer to the bodhicitta. Starting from the beginning, should not make any mistake, and then step by step. Otherwise, what is the use, I think? Talking, what is the use? And better to enjoy. Yeah? Now I'm inviting some questions, okay? I think I really don't like to talk a lot. English is very bad, brain is very bad, I'm a little bit tired, and then I talk this a lot, so therefore sometimes I start having some frustration, you see. Therefore, if anyone asks some questions, it will be very, very healing for me. Yes.
We need to use this just for the streaming people.
Geshe-la.
Yes?
Of course, I have read too that Bodhicitta, this is the center beam, the most important thing. But as well, like, that's not the end, it's like the beginning. A new Bodhisattva, he would have to proceed with the six perfections and all of that. So, could you talk about the distinction? There's a metaphor of praying and actually engaging.
Roughly, I explained how to start, you see. Yes. First, we have to take refuge in Buddha, Dharma, Sangha. Okay? We try to build a really strong faith. Unshakable faith in Buddha, Dharma, Sangha. With the reason, okay, with the logic. Okay, and from there, you will be able to cultivate renunciation. That means build a strong determination to be free from samsara. Okay? And this is for the sake of one's own self. And then we see many people suffering, and they start, just doing everything for myself is not enough. There are so many people suffering. I really wanted to help every sentient being without differentiating. I really wanted to help other sentient beings to be free from samsara. Compassion. After compassion, then Bodhicitta is almost like in the hand. Yeah? Yeah. So I think the cultivating strong faith in Buddha. Okay, in Buddha, who gives such a wonderful teaching, Dharma, and then profound friend, Dharma friends, who guide unmistakably. Now these days, we say he's following the Dalai Lama, okay? He's really giving profound teaching. The only thing is we are lacking our practice. Our devotion. He taught, okay, for me, he taught a lot. So, I told you this like this, you see, and this is how we have to start and how we have to practice. And then also six perfections. Generosity, okay? If we give, without Bodhicitta, if we give something, it is generosity. But after having cultivation of Bodhicitta, if we give something, that becomes perfection of generosity. Why? Then that generosity will go directly to be able to achieve Buddhahood. Therefore, this is the perfection of generosity. If we follow some discipline, this becomes the perfection of discipline. If we do meditation on single-pointed meditation, this becomes the perfection of single-pointed meditation. And then wisdom also. If this is really motivated or influenced by Bodhicitta, everything goes for the perfection of perfection, you see, because it gives a result of perfection, which is Buddha. I think now I did answer a little bit more than what you asked. Okay, so is there any, still do you have any? So we have to build a very strong faith in Buddha. Now today, okay, after 2,600 years, still Buddha's teaching so valid. If you just think how the destructive emotion grows in us, how it destroys us, how it makes us unhappy, and then if you read Buddha's teaching, it's exactly there. And then if we try to minimize this, and then we will achieve some peace, happiness, exactly explained in the Buddha's teaching. Yeah. Yeah, I think we can have a break. 8 o'clock. Oh, yes, yes, please. Yes. Yeah.
I'll try to make this short. For someone who aspires to bodhicitta, bodhicitta, but hasn't achieved it yet.
Yeah.
Isn't very, very strong determination the same as striving or clinging? And if we fall short, doesn't that lead to suffering?
That is strong in a bad way, you see. Yeah, in a very negative way. If someone didn't achieve bodhicitta, okay, still say that clinging or strong feeling, this is simply attachment, you see. So first thing is really have to know the meaning of bodhicitta, and then try to study how we can cultivate bodhicitta. And then as bodhicitta, you see, practice is when you go to the vows or the vows of the Bodhisattvas. And the first one is Dakdui Shemen, Chunami Dakdui Shemen. The main purpose is to reduce selfish thinking, isn't it? Bodhisattva's practice is mainly to reduce selfish thinking and think more for others. When you say thought-transforming teachings, means thought-transform means up to now, I have been trying to do everything good for myself. Now, I wanted to achieve Buddhahood. Therefore, I reduce this and I try to put all my focus for the sake of other sentient beings. Then bodhicitta is possible. This is not bias, okay? And this is... Did I answer you or...? Because my poor English, sometimes I don't understand the question and then I give answers. So please just say, okay? If it's not right, you just have to ask me, okay? Yeah. To exchange. Up to now, I have been trying everything for myself. And now, I started practicing. Slowly, I reduced my selfish thinking and then increased the importance of others' welfare. And then slowly, one day, you will think that others important, others' welfare is so important. Why? Because it's a big number, really big number. Myself, it's only one person. And then we feel that it is justified, totally justified, that to think and to do or speak everything for others' welfare is very good, okay? Very good. And then even if I wanted to think of myself, if I really wanted to be happy, I cannot be happy just by myself. I have to achieve happiness from others, you see. If I'm sick, I have to go to others to get medicine. If I need a friend, I have to go to others. If I'm hungry, I have to go to others, you see. Without depending upon others, there's no way I can achieve even a single ordinary happiness. I can't achieve. Therefore, others are so important, you see. So important, practically. I'm just existing, depending upon others. Without depending upon others, there's no way I can survive. Therefore, His Holiness always said that we can live without religion, but we cannot survive without human affection. Yeah. So, bodhicitta is focusing on others, okay? Yeah, and it's really healthy, very healthy, okay? It will not make you completely burn out. No way. We are getting tired because we are just doing something for others and then dragging towards this and then releasing this and then we get tired. We're doing this, you see? totally given. Whew. So I think we break. So have some break. Now I think we talked a little bit about the second chapter and the third chapter. So some people who are having no teeth, you see, no teeth, and then you have to taste something, then you have to swallow, you see, not properly chewing. So we also swallow the second chapter and third chapter, okay? Okay. Second chapter is, and according to this schedule, it's nicely written, you see. Preparing, that is, I think, really nice words. And some they translate as a confession, which is also not wrong, but then confession also may have different meaning. So I will explain a little bit. The preparing is very good. Preparing the awakening mind. Preparing means second chapter is try to make us a little bit cleaner, you see. Mentally cleaner, not body. Body is okay if you don't take shower for 1 year, it's okay. Still, you can cultivate Bodhicitta. To cultivate Bodhicitta, you don't have to take shower every day. No, not needed. So, but then, mind really has to take shower every day. If possible, 3 times, 4 times, you see. So to clean mind, okay, to purify mind, and the second chapter comes. Why? Because Bodhicitta is very, very healthy food. Okay, healthy food. And if our mind is filled with so many contamination, it will never be able to digest. Therefore, if anyone who really wanted to cultivate Bodhicitta, first important thing is that you have to remove all these negativities, okay? Negativities, bad karmas or bad thoughts, all these, try to, if possible, okay, destructive emotions also, but the main thing is the bad karma, okay, non-virtuous action, accumulated, like eons. And because of this, mind is totally overloaded with all these dirty things. By having this dirtiness, okay, and then to cultivate Bodhicitta is not possible. Because the difference of the main mind and the Bodhicitta becomes so huge. And then this mind transforming into Bodhicitta is so far. Therefore, prepare, try to clean the mind. Okay, either doing by prostration or by some saying mantra or some prayer or and doing some generosity and confessions and those so many, okay. And then rejoicing the good things of Buddhas and Bodhisattvas and spiritual teachers. And in this way, if you do these practices and slowly, slowly, your mind become more clean. Less contaminated, okay? And then if you practice Bodhicitta, will be very successful. And filled, all whole mind is filled with so many dirty, okay, contamination, heavily, okay, overloaded mind, and then thinking Bodhicitta, doing meditation will, okay? And then after some time, then you'll know what I was doing. Started with Bodhicitta, cultivation of Bodhicitta, and on the way forgot, you see. Because sleepy, drowsy, tired, unclear, because of the contamination. And then after 1 hour, what did I do? How did I start it? Oh, I have to look to the note. Oh, I started with Bodhicitta. Why it happened? Because of the contamination on the mind. Therefore, we say six limb practices, okay. Chakdeva, Chunshava, Chakseva is prostration, is one very profound practice to purify or to confess, to make our mind clean, okay, clean. Chujing is doing offering to Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, okay? Chujing. Then try to recollect all the bad things you did and try to recollect, and you just think that by thinking this, then you feel that almost you have eaten a poison. Really wanted to vomit or throw it out, otherwise we can't stay in a calm way. So by having these bad things, bad actions, bad thoughts, and then there's no way, because this will bring lot of sufferings, you see. So by having this motivation, instead of cultivating jealousy, if someone does something good thing, sometimes we feel jealous, isn't it? I don't know. Try to have a rejoice, okay? In Tibetan we say Geshe Pema Dorjee. Geshe Pema Dorjee means if someone does something very, very good thing, and after seeing this, we feel the appreciation, respect, okay? And then that is called rejoice. And this will also clean the contamination coming through what? Jealousy. And Chandrava Chujin, Shabbata, Jesuita, Buddhism, so on. And try to pray or to request the profound spiritual teachers to stay as long as possible and turn the Dharma wheel, okay? Wherever is possible. And don't leave us, okay, in the darkness. Please light us by giving teaching of light. And so, and all these things, wholeheartedly, if we just go on practicing these, and slowly, slowly, your mind become more clean, and then one day mind will become like a fertile land, fertile soil, where we can put any types of things. It will grow very nicely. Yeah. And that if the mind is totally contaminated, and then we cannot grow anything, you see. Especially, it's impossible to grow Bodhicitta. So the second chapter, in short, this is second chapter. Finished. It's peanut. Yeah. I think almost, yeah, in short, okay, this is the meaning of the second chapter. Here, in this program, prepare, okay? Prepare one's own self, okay? Really a very, very clean mind, so that if we do meditation practice of cultivating bodhicitta, it will really grow nicely. If the mind is totally contaminated, especially with the selfish thinking, okay? Selfish, very self-centered. And then Bodhicitta will go far. More we practice, we are practicing selfish thinking, and Bodhicitta will go far. We say, oh, I cultivate Bodhicitta, but give all the bad thing, good thing to me and throw all the bad thing to others. Now I need the best house, I need the I'm doing meditation of Bodhicitta. Bodhicitta will go far. Do you understand me? Yeah. Therefore, the second chapter, this Padmakara translated. Huh? Confession, yeah. Confession. Again, of course, my friend Steve always asks, what is the meaning of confession? It has its own meaning, you see. In Buddhism, there's no one who can say that going to that person and say, please forgive me and purify all my sin. If that person says, okay, now from today you are free from all those bad things. It's not possible in Buddhism, you see. Even Buddha himself cannot do. Buddha cannot wash the sins or the bad things of the person. You see, Buddha cannot wash by water. Buddha cannot pick up the sufferings of other sentient beings and throw in the garbage. Not possible. Buddha achieved a lot of accomplishment, you see. Bodhicitta, wisdom, so many good qualities. Buddha cannot give part of it and they say, okay, you take this. You don't have to do meditation because you are my mother, so you take my Bodhicitta and now you have package of Bodhicitta. Not possible, you see. How Buddha leads us, he gives the teaching, okay, which is totally truth, and based on truth and out of compassion, and then he leads us. And that is the way he also practices in this way. Therefore, compassion is, if someone comes, oh, Geshe-la, please confess me, or say, okay, you are confessed free. It is not possible in Tibetan Buddhism. Only you have to do, okay, in the way I explained, if you did something wrong, if you harm the life of so many sentient beings, and then your purification, best purification is to save, okay, try to save the lives of as many as possible, okay, lives of other sentient beings. Yeah? Among the generosity, there are three different types of generosity. I think the last one is almost like saving the life of any sentient being whose lives are in big danger, okay? If we save that life, and this is one of the best purification, you see, if we have done something to harm others' life. And so on, okay, so on. Therefore, to prepare one's own self to be a fit person to cultivate bodhicitta, and then all these negativities or contaminations has to be removed. And that teaching is the second chapter. Now I don't want to say again, then I will repeat again. And then third one, and what is third one? Through prayers and rituals, and also visualization, we also can take Bodhisattva's vow. Okay, we can take Bodhisattva's vow. By taking this, we feel we have some obligation. You see, by taking this, I should not be so selfish. The first one. Means if you started praising yourself and making yourself in an important place, and the first vow says that don't do this. And then if you take Bodhisattva's vow from a really good spiritual teacher, and then visualizing that all the Buddhas, Bodhisattvas are there, if you take this, then you will feel that, oh, I have taken this vow, so I will not break this. Yeah? Mm. And... two different types of bodhicitta, do you need to explain? Maybe, I think I didn't explain. That is in the first chapter. That is the difference between the expression of bodhicitta and engaged bodhicitta. Okay? The difference is, if there's someone, okay, who wanted to go to Washington, D.C. One says, I really wanted to go to Washington, D.C. I really wanted to go to Washington, D.C. That is expression of bodhicitta type, okay? And one says, oh, I really wanted to go to Washington, D.C., so I will take the train and then I will move. Okay. It goes nearer, nearer, nearer to the Washington, D.C. That is engaged Bodhicitta, you see. So motivation or the intention or to achieve Buddhahood for the sake of all sentient beings is there. But one is just, I really wanted to achieve Buddhahood for the sake of all sentient beings. I really wanted to achieve Buddhahood for the sake of all sentient beings. Oh, please help me. I wanted to. That is aspiration of Bodhicitta. I wanted to achieve Buddhahood for the sake of all sentient beings. For that, I have to practice generosity. I have to practice ethical discipline. I have to practice single point meditation. I have to practice wisdom. Practice, practice, practice. And then it will take you nearer, nearer, nearer to the. So that is engaged Bodhicitta, okay? Drawa dhyata drawa yi chidra njata nyendava tishin kheva di yi chidra rimshi shevar cha. So all these are, okay, all these, the strong wish to cultivate Bodhicitta is possible if our minds are clean. Clean, you see? If our minds are totally contaminated, and just by listening some teaching, there's a very small, small wish to achieve Buddhahood for the sake of a sentient being. Very weak, okay? Because teacher taught, okay? Because of this, we may, oh yes, I really want to achieve Buddhahood for the sake of all sentient being. But then I have to take a cup of coffee, so, okay? Not so important, because of the contamination. Yeah. If the contaminations are really thin, almost clean, then I really want to achieve Buddhahood for the sake of all sentient beings. It becomes so, so appealing. Yeah. I don't know. Do you understand what I'm explaining? Do you see the difference, you see? Mm-hmm. So therefore, preparing the Bodhicitta, preparing the ground or the fertile land so that really the healthiest practice of Bodhicitta will grow there. Well, that is the confession chapter, okay? Then the last chapter is up to this, and you are really ready to take the Bodhisattva's vow through some ritual, prayer and visualization, and also without these also, you can also directly go to transform your mind into Bodhicitta, it's possible, you see. So both way, normally ordinary people to have Bodhicitta easily is quite difficult, therefore prepare and then take some vows and from a very profound teacher and visualize Buddhas and Bodhisattva around them and their spiritual teacher. And in front of them, I say, I will try my best to do everything for the sake of all sentient beings, and I will try ignore myself, okay? And then in this way, and then we follow the Bodhisattva's vow. And this makes us stronger. And if we go on practicing this, and one day, really it will change into, our mind will really change into Bodhicitta. Yeah. But don't think it's very easy, you see. By taking a vow, you will become a Buddha, Bodhisattva. That is not possible. Yeah. You will get some sort of inspiration, and you will also get some sort of like a responsibility that I have taken this vow, so I have to act like Bodhisattva. I try not to be so selfish. I really wanted to be less selfish. Okay, I will give the victory to others, and I will take the laws, all this. And then slowly, slowly, and then mind will be changed into Bodhicitta. Some people, okay, even they ask me a question, if I take Bodhisattva's vow from someone, and is it that my mind is already changed into Bodhicitta? Then it's difficult, you see. Bodhicitta is not that sort of easy. It will motivate you, okay? It will give us to some encouragement or inspiration to cultivate real bodhicitta. Yeah. And by practicing this, we will go nearer to the bodhicitta. But simply just taking a ritual and prayer, and then saying that my mind is changed to bodhicitta, then it's not possible. This is a big debate. When we study about bodhicitta, it's a big debate. And I agree in this way. Some have their own way. Chapter 3 is also finished. I think we will be able to finish Bodhisattva's way of life today. So purification, do you have any question? Or confession, religious confession? What do you think about the confession in Buddhism? Still we have a lot of time, so what shall we do? Now, of course, if it is. I see. You want to practice, and then after that you will ask question next year. Your question will be next year.
So I grew up in the United States and did some of the things that you were talking about earlier, like reading newspapers and watching television and so on. And I think that there are some things about American culture that encourage, for lack of a better word, contamination. So that sometimes at work, I feel like I'm being encouraged to be selfish in order to advance in my career. Or sometimes I'm encouraged by advertising to want things that I don't need. And so if I were to take vows and move to a monastery where I was surrounded with people who supported my aspirations, that would be helpful. But I wonder if you have some suggestions or some ideas about how it's possible to live in a culture and also avoid or reduce some contamination from our surroundings.
My view is a little bit, radical. Because of course I did study in monastery, but I didn't remain in the monastery. And of course in the monastery we can practice a lot of many good things. But I felt that we don't have much challenge in the monasteries. So if I come out, see the society, and especially very difficult societies in the villages, so many problems, you see. And I see the politicians, and then the corruptions, and all these things, you see. So then there's a lot of challenge, you see. Try not to get angry with the politicians. Very important, you see. So now I have this money, okay. My friend gave me this money. Okay, now I have to hide. Otherwise, some people will say that to take care of the money, it's a big responsibility. Very scary, you see. I think today my friend announced that I'm trying to do something about the girls who are in trafficking, you see. And when I was there, some of my sincere friend came and said, please, please, don't do this. Because then your life will be in danger. Your life, you will be no more tomorrow, okay? It's possible. So just please don't do. They sincerely came to me. And at that time, I was really quiet. Still, I'm very quiet. I'm very quiet. I'm doing, but I don't announce. So there are a lot of challenge, a lot of challenge. If I stay in the monastery, this challenge is not there. And therefore, of course, it depends upon the individual. But I will say, I'm a little bit radical. Why? Because one thing I was, I really don't want to be trained by any other teacher. But I really wanted to be the best teacher. I wanted to be a good teacher, you see. It's radical. Not much logics. But I really wanted to. And then I say, okay, I study Buddhist philosophy in the monastery, but I really don't want to remain in the monastery. I really have to come out and see and where there's more challenge, more difficulties, you see. And there's so many. When we went to distribute some rice, was it rice or no, like plastic sheets to have the roof, you see. And then we distribute to one village. We have enough for one village, we counted. And the other village came. Say, if you want to give to both of us, welcome. If you want to give that village, we really want you to stop. Stick. You see? And then there's no way we can explain. So we have to go back and prepare for both and then go and then distribute. Actually, even if they stop, you see, even they stop, they will not gain anything. The mind, you see, they feel that if they give to that village, they feel very unhappy, have pain because of jealousy. So this problem I really see in a very visible. And then we have chance to cultivate tolerance and also chance to see the reality. Not only in the meditation, good or bad, equalizing and all these, not only meditation, but we see that in a practical level. So that is why I think it depends upon every individual. For me, I didn't stay in the monastery not much, you see, and worked in the society. And now I'm working in quite a difficult sort of places. And so if I collapse, of course I will collapse really badly. If I succeed, it can be quite good, you see. So, see. Then when it comes to say, a student, I don't like students who are very polite. I don't like. I like students who are a little bit restless. Because then our brain also works better, you see. How to check, and we have to be very alert, you see. And then very polite, and we fall asleep, you see. So see your potential of the mind, your strength of the mind. Okay? If your mind is really strong, just enter into difficult situations. And your practice will be much more rewarding. Yeah? Yeah. Now this is what I'm saying, okay, through my life experience. It is difficult, yeah. Yeah.
Are you saying that staying in this society where it is difficult to remain practicing because there's, oh. So I'm taking from what you said that if we stay in this society, which makes it difficult to really practice, that's a good challenge?
Yes, but then I will say, in the beginning you might need some sort of like a relaxed time, maybe. And I was thinking, I had a very good thought then. old people coming, yeah. Buddha, okay, Shakyamuni, he planned to be born on a period of very difficult and a place where there's a lot of problem. Okay? is strengthen is like a lot of fighting and all these things, because then his teaching is more needed. Yeah. So in we have like we according to our Buddhism, the realms. Okay, we have many. We have first we have like say three realms. Okay, we are realm of desire, and then we have form realm, and then formless realm. So form realm, formless realms are very very peaceful, very almost no anger, no gross level of destructive emotions. But then all the Bodhisattvas say that we don't want to go there. Why it is so calm? And they are so happy, and they will not listen to teaching, you see. Therefore, where there's more challenge, and then also our practice also goes well, and the teaching is also needed more there. Yeah. Do you see the logic? Yeah. And especially if we have compassion. Compassion will definitely say that where there's more problem, more disturbance, and there is the need of the compassionate person. Yeah. Therefore, I think, in the West, okay, your life is very busy, and life is really conditioned, you see, and you have so much obligation. Here, we don't see so many people standing on the road, you see. Everyone going like this. In India or Nepal, we see hundreds of people standing on the road, you see. And some are just standing there all day. As most of the in India, if you go to Delhi, you check. Most of men are outside and women are at home. And all those men are just standing on the road and in the place and cutting jaw and playing some carrying board. And so they have a lot of time and so they don't have much worry. In the evening, they get a dinner. But here, you have a lot of obligations. You have to pay tax, isn't it? And then many of you have to pay the mortgage. And there are many things. And the electricity bills are also very, very handsome. And there are so many things you have to pay. Otherwise, you cannot exist, you see. But in India and Nepal, it's okay. Roof is falling down. Oh, I think if it is not fall down today, it's okay. Really, completely different, you see. Therefore, you have more challenge. I'm saying more challenge. But I think if you really overcome this challenge, you are really good person. Yeah, good person, yeah. Do I say something? Yes.
Geshe-la, could you differentiate between relative bodhicitta and ultimate bodhicitta?
Uh-huh. What? First one was what? Ultimate bodhicitta and? Relative, okay. Now, there's relative bodhicitta. Some people say conventional bodhicitta. Some people say what? There's another term in English, yeah. But it doesn't matter. So what we are talking today is relative bodhicitta or conventional bodhicitta. So we didn't talk anything about the ultimate bodhicitta, okay? If we talk about ultimate bodhicitta, it has to be wisdom. Ultimate bodhicitta has to be wisdom, okay? But then any wisdom is not okay. The wisdom which is highly or totally influenced by bodhicitta, and that wisdom is called ultimate bodhicitta. Not ordinary wisdom, okay? Wisdom which is based on emptiness, okay? Emptiness. And this wisdom, if it is influenced by bodhicitta, then this wisdom is called ultimate bodhicitta. Okay? And if I don't have any wisdom, there's no way we can say any types of ultimate. Ultimate bodhicitta is actually, it is a wisdom which understands the ultimate reality of the phenomena. And that wisdom, if it is influenced by bodhicitta, then it becomes ultimate bodhicitta. We debate, okay, ultimate bodhicitta, is it bodhicitta? We say no. Why it is called bodhicitta, ultimate bodhicitta? Because it is influenced by bodhicitta. Therefore, it is called ultimate bodhicitta. Is it bodhicitta? No. Bodhicitta has to be conventional bodhicitta or relative bodhicitta. Yeah. This is easy, isn't it? So we debated, okay. Kunzo Changju Sen, the Tendam Changju Sen said, she would wa. Now, relative bodhicitta and Kunzo Changju Sen che. And ultimate bodhicitta is the Tendam Changju Sen. The Tendam Changju Sen is the Tony to Vishra in Korwa. Tony to Vishra and Changju Sen Yam to Yamle Chesna, and the ultimate bodhicitta. The Changju Sen Chipoina, and then Kunzo Changju Sen, the relative Changju Sen, because bodhicitta. And the dish shall not worry. The quarter tree and the mana can see, lava. Okay. Oh, did you? Did you get to the next question? Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Tishashi, this chick, some call, Lel Harus, Korgidua, or Tanya Soji in the chain.
The Jay is about
that it was Sasun, that the Timasu Summer Jumuda. That bench is not same dying, not in the Tata Timothy swim, not same Jawa Chashan, the Dinsukasim, Kandidish Kevin.
Not same
Jawa Chashan, not same dying, Lota Yura,
no longer
doing a Dingmasu, the Kushash Kevra,
that
Tishashi is in some Kirdan hundred of Kevin.
Alle.
So I'm basically asking about, because we know about like general different kinds of non-virtuous actions that we do, right? Say, example, killing. So killing is something that we can relate to, like, okay, I did this kind of killing, like killing an insect, fishing also. So this is something like we can think that, okay, I can do the repentance quite easily because I can relate to that. But in terms of other non-virtuous actions like covetousness and
wrong views,
right? So I'm lost in that area and I'm asking for his guidance. Thank you.
to confess or purify the negativities earned by killing someone, he feels that this is easier to confess, to purify, because we feel, oh, I killed, okay. Very easy to understand, oh, I have killed, so I really wanted to remove this negativity from my mind. Yeah. But then, if we have wrong view, then first thing is whether I have wrong view or not is very difficult, you see. And after many doing a lot of analysis, and then if we understood that I have a wrong view, and then to clean this, okay, he says this is more difficult. Yes, this is more difficult, you see. Because among the wrong view, there are, I think, at least three different wrong views. First wrong view is like we say that everything is existing independently. There is one wrong view, which is very subtle, very subtle. Another wrong view is, oh, if we do good thing, it will not give any good result. If we do bad thing, it will not give any bad result, suffering. No, it will not give any suffering. There is another wrong view. And sometimes wrong view, we are led by some teacher, you see. Some teacher taught something wrong, which is not true. And we also led by this teacher, and then we end up with a wrong view. So it can be few or wrong views. So these are more difficult to purify or to confess. Through this wrong view, we do a lot of bad things. Yeah. If we say, oh, if we do good thing, we will achieve happiness. If we do something wrong like killing, then we will suffer. This is not possible, you see. Someone who was doing really bad thing, but he is so happy and he is so rich, and we see it practically in this life. But these are different factors coming, different result. He's rich because he killed animal? No. I mean, he killed, but the rich is coming from another good karma. So therefore, these are, more subtle. Therefore, doing confession is also more difficult. But then it also depends upon the one's own practice. And some people who are totally focused on the mind training, just totally on the mind training, to their level, almost all the negativities are quite similar. Yeah. And those who are like a random sort of practicing, doing, and then I think the killing is more easier to purify than wrong view, because it's more subtle. Because killing, there's action, thinking and then action, which we see with our own eye. The wrong view, we don't see anything. Just only almost like a thought, you see, wrong thought. Therefore, it's more difficult. Therefore, to practice emptiness, or to practice wisdom based on emptiness is very important. Because this is the best instrument to destroy all the wrong views, including ignorance. Yeah. And this is very difficult. When you explain, it looks like quite easy. Sometimes we explain everything in a very short and say, oh, now I understand emptiness, you see. You see? But then when you sit down and think, then almost nothing is there. Okay? In words you understood, but if you think, close your eye and do meditation, then almost nothing there, you see. Nothing there. Almost you didn't study about this. Nothing there. Went so far. This shows that it is very, very difficult, you see. Yeah. Have to think again. Today I think, oh, I understood emptiness. Now I'm doing meditation on emptiness. If you meditate, not so much is there, okay. But if you just think again, do meditation again, then it becomes more clear. And that is the meaning of the meditation, which is called to make the things familiar to the mind. Familiar, okay. Doing again makes the mind very familiar to this. Bodhicitta. If you practice again, and then the Bodhicitta become more familiar to your mind and more closer. Yeah. That to do it. This do it. He didn't say very good. He said just okay. If I check, if I ask myself, am I really a Buddhist? And now I'm going again, am I really Buddhist? Yes, sometimes I'm Buddhist. Sometimes not, you see. Why? Because I explained you, isn't it? Buddhist means the person who who has really strong faith in Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. Okay? And strong faith, having strong faith, when you think we have strong faith, and you are doing something else, which are more important, then this strong faith goes back, you see, almost like it becomes like imprint on the mind. At that time, am I really Buddhist? Bodhicitta is also like this. Bodhicitta. I don't know. It's, when you are sleeping, okay, if someone is Bodhisattva, and then that Bodhisattva sleeps, okay, sleep. Okay, now, can we call that person as a Bodhisattva? There's more difficult issue, okay? If someone is like, we have like, in Buddhism, we have five paths, okay? Part of accumulation, part of preparation, and part of seeing. When someone doing a lot of practice and that their mind change into part of seeing, these parts are all mind, okay? A part of seeing. That means this mind is totally concentrated on the emptiness. There's no other thing, okay? Just totally on the emptiness. And during that time, we say, the Bodhicitta is not possible. Why? Because Bodhicitta is in the form of imprint, but the mind is totally focused on the emptiness, and that too is like a seeing the emptiness as we see an object with our naked eye. So therefore, during that time, does this Bodhisattva, whether he has a Bodhicitta or not, is a big debate. But this is useless, isn't it? First we cultivate Bodhicitta and then think whether this is there or not. At present, we don't have Bodhicitta, therefore better not to talk, isn't it? The sleeping, when you are sleeping soundly, do you think that that person has a strong desire during that time, sleeping time, or having a very, very delicious lunch? Delicious lunch. Oh, this is so good. And during that time, that person, okay, in his mind, is there any kinds of bodhicitta or whatever, okay? Anger is not there, isn't it? When we are now, we are talking, we are smiling, and so we have no problem, so we are not angry. So where is anger? So we say it is in the form of imprints. Okay? If it is in the form of imprints, then is he angry? No, because anger is not activated, isn't it? And then and same, if someone has a bodhicitta and sleeping, at that time, is he Bodhisattva? Maybe we have to say no, in the same answer. Do you understand? In this way, we debate in this way. But of course, this is not so important. So first, we have to try to cultivate bodhicitta. Buddhist debate is very interesting. Yeah. Very interesting, you see. Now in South India, they are putting science into Buddhist dialect, debate dialect. Yeah. They say they get a better understanding. I hope it will be very successful, you see. Now quite a big group, especially really very good scholar from Buddhist education, Now they are studying science and try to put science into their dialect, the dialect of debate. Once we had some discussion, you see, if we say, okay, in this big hall, there are about 50 people, okay? And then when we debate, all the 50 people are good people. If we ask this question, then we have to think, you see, we have to think, if we just say yes, and then that person says, okay, that person did some criminal thing, so is still a good man. And then slowly we get real answer, you see. This also is wrong, this is also wrong, this is right. And finally, okay, I see, this is the correct answer. So this dialect is very, very, very good. Therefore, when it comes to the mind, and without this technique, and then it's very difficult to understand what thoughts are coming, what thoughts are in the imprints form, and is it real? And the imprint, among the imprint, there are subtle imprint which will never activate it, you see. For example, one person who is about to achieve nirvana, if that person has earned a really bad karma, many years ago, and then because of his practice, that person achieve nirvana, okay? And that imprint of bad karma will never activate it. Because to activate bad karma needs some destructive emotion. And some person who achieved nirvana has no destructive emotion. Even seed has the potential to germinate. If you don't put any water, it will never germinate, you see. Something like that, similar. So therefore, to purify negativities, which are activated and seen in a gross level, to purify these are easier, but then those which are in the form of imprints are much difficult. Therefore, we need to have a practice of single-pointed meditation plus wisdom. Then only this can remove all the imprints, okay, subtle imprints. Therefore, in Buddhism, we say that to develop wisdom combined with single-pointed meditation is very important. Now, we are dealing with the ninth chapter, so I hope I will be able to explain a little bit of the ninth chapter. Yeah. And then eighth chapter is single-pointed. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So if you don't have any question, then I think we can finish. It's 9 o'clock, and I think we used a little bit more than 9. Okay? Thank you. Thank you.